What's up? Welcome, welcome. Today's day one. I was thinking 1 year and how many days? Yeah, so no, it's day 383, making Songbringer. And today I'm making, working on the fire dungeon, finalizing those kinds of things. I'm excited to have the bloom shader looking a lot better. The door's all working now. So let me show off this new bloom shader. It's so great. So freaking great. I almost want to cry. It's so awesome. You can see, like, it really hones in on just the right things that need to be bloomed. So, like, the sword on the player's back. When the sword's out, it looks bloomed. This bloom effect might be a little bit much at this point. I can always tone it down by just changing some constants. So as you get closer to, like, see the doors have the bloom as well. Anything that's really bright has this bloom effect, and then also there's a really nice, if all the other pixels in the rest of the screen, like you're looking at the top left of the screen now, it's all blurred out. Ooh, I need to change my FPS because I'm streaming. Forgot about that. So that's really awesome, and now I'm moving into finalizing things so I can have a beta update ready for probably tomorrow night, which will have the fire dungeon. So today is going to be finishing up the fire dungeon, and tomorrow we'll be refining everything and then releasing. So this will be beta update 086B or something like that, fire dungeon. All right, so the first thing on my task list today is to place the fire armor, which is gonna go. I'm just trying to make sure if the game show is even working. I think game show is working. Hope so. All right. Yeah. So the fire armor. What's up, Arcane? Welcome. It is not possible. Ha! You've done the impossible. You have done it, my friend. So this is really simple. I got the armor created. I got the dungeon created. Now I just need to place it. I need to place the armor in a dungeon that is before the dungeon where you'd get, where before the fire dungeon, basically. So see, the primary goal items and secondary goal items are randomized. Finally, we have some privacy. so how you been, man? What's going on? What's going on in Arcane's world? So I think this fire armor is called Shadrach's Tear. And I think this is going to go into a goal item. So it'll be in like Dungeon 5, for example's goal item will be Shadrach's Tear. And then Dungeon 6, 7, or 8 could be the Fire Dungeon. So the first thing it does is it sets Blink and Teleport to be the first two goal items. And then it puts in the randomized goal items, the primaries, and then the randomized secondaries. Boogie, what's up, buddy? Game show's back to working today. Finalizing up the fire dungeon. And I got a new bloom shader. The bloom shader is all done finally. And it looks good and it works a lot faster. You passed your exam? Nice! Wow, cool. Nice. You got a 3 month vacation up? Right on. What's going on in my world? Just Songbringer. Hey, nice. Wow, that's random. Good timing, man. You like literally got here 5 minutes after I started. It's amazing. How do you do it? So where, what are these primary goal items? Oh yeah. Shield 2, boots, fire. So dungeon 1 and 2 are already taken up. That would be 3, 4, 5. Yeah, I guess we can squeeze. Wait a minute. What if I take out? Where's shield one? What's up, Zanger? Yeah, totally. Songbird is getting more polished every day, especially these new bloom, the bloom shader, and all that's helping it look a lot more polished. It's a nice combo of bloom and a focus blur, so the edges of the screen are blurred, and it's really, really efficient. What's up, Sadongs? Yeah, I got it down from like instead of like 16 texture lookups per pixel or whatever, it's down to like only 6 texture lookups per pixel. So, and it works unique. It's not like a typical bloom shader at all. As you can see, it uses triangle shapes. Yeah, so if you look at the player, I just see how his sword and his eyes are lit up and they glow a little bit. In fact, here I'll turn off the shaders, and you can see. So here's what the game looked like before, right? This is what the game typically looks like, for the last like 6 months or whatever. It looked about like that, and then so you can turn this on and off now in your quality settings. You just go to settings, video, quality, and if I turn it back to awesome, it'll use all the shaders. So see how the player, his eyes light up and the sword lights up, and this and the door too, the south door right there, you can see a lot of the light there is bloomed out. Any suggestions on how to handle collisions with an ECS? Been trying to think of a best way to do it over the last couple days. Well, yeah, I got some suggestions. Well, I mean, it's a lot of it's an inner working. Are you talking about the way that the systems have to work together to make co collision detection work? Because to make collision detection work, well, this is the way I designed it here for Songbringer or whatever. There's the position component. That's the every part, everything that has a collision, that takes part in the collision detection, has to have a position component, and it has to have a collision component. And so the collision component, essentially the position component is just the position. You could ignore like pretty much all the rest of the data that a position component represents. And really, the most important part is just whatever position that entity is using. And then your collision component really just boils down to a size. That's really all the collision component really is, just the size of the entity. And there's a lot of other important things too, like its category, which is a mask basically, and damage and things like that. But really what matters at first with getting the collision system working is like the size. So then once you've got an entity's size and yeah, that's basically it. Yeah, so once you've got your data set up, you just literally loop over all the things and check if they collide. Let me show you how my collision system does that. Maybe this will help. So the tick for collision system here, it basically, see this? It runs over all the collision components, and it looks them up and checks if it's paused. And here's where the actual collision detection happens right here. It calls self get collision and passes in the mask, and this gets it interprets the position of the entity and the collision size of the entity. And so get collision, all get collision does is it just loops over every single other cached. This is the important part though, is it does cache all the objects. So every single tick, it'll reset its cache and then recache the objects as soon as it needs to. And by caching the objects, it simply just loops over all of the entities that might have collision components and then stashes them all. So it doesn't have to look up all the position components and the collision components again. So everything is all cached out. And along with the cache, it's actually caching by mask. So it can do its collision detection for foes first, for example, or friends or whatever. So, but this is all just kind of like greasing the wheels, you know what I mean? It's just making it a lot faster, just having this cache. But I would recommend having something like this because this really, really improved the performance of the collision detection engine, because every time you're doing your loop over all the other objects, you have to do these lookups. So your entity component system has to do a lookup for that collision component and a lookup for that position component. And if you've already looked them all up and you already know what everything might be that might collide, and you've also filtered them out a little bit and sorted them in their places, that's really going to help it run faster. So basically, yeah, it's just a loop over every entity. I hope that helped. If there's anything you want me to go into more detail on. So where is item shield? Oh, that's a primary gate. Oh, that's a gate item. Great. So shield 2 does not necessarily need to be a goal item. Let's make shield 3. Nice. Yeah, it is. It's easy enough. It really is. Shield 3 will become a secret. There. Put it here. This looks good. So I'm rearranging items here a little bit so I can place the fire armor, which is now called Shadrach's tier. Okay, so now I've taken one item away from the goal items. What is taking so long? Yeah, re-index Xcode, just do it. Just get your indexing out of the way. So we've got those goal items. Let's push back one more. Here we go, dungeon goal items. So we've got those manual. Here's another manual item. After we place the primary goal items, we place the fire armor. Okay, and I want to see this after it places all these items. So I want to make sure that it did put this in the right place. The next step will be to make the fire dungeon one of the dungeons after the fire armor. All right, I think it was just Xcode eating up the CPU there. All right. So run that, check these items, make sure that everything's still good here. Oh, whoops, got a wrong goal item size. That's probably because I didn't update it now. It should be 4. Cool. Okay, so I'm going to take a look at dungeon goal items. That might be part of this. Nope. Christmas. There we go. Okay, so after it applies the first two, we've got blink and teleport. Right, okay, yeah, I put teleport in this is the third dungeon. Skips the second one because the second one's a swordless. Swordless has a special goal items. Put in the primary goal items, and we've got boots and fire. Now we're going to put in the fire armor. Should come in right after that. Great, we got dungeon 5 as the fire armor. And then we fill in those. We still haven't done the alt dungeon yet, but we've got fire armor, glove, chip. None. Oh, ending is going to be this last one. Yeah, ending? Great, cool. Let me just put a comment here. So next time I get to this bit of code, I can see at a glance what's going on. Cool. Okay, now we place the fire armor. I want to place the fire dungeon next. So this is just setting a style. Actually, I already know that the fire dungeon is always going to be. It's always going to be 6 through 9. 6 through 8 actually would be a good one. So we just make it random from 6 to 8. Right, so we get fire armor in dungeon 6. Oh, so it's either 7 or 8 is the fire dungeon. Or, oh, actually, I got a better idea. We'll put. Put the boots. This is getting. This is getting really crazy. I should just not randomize the primary goal items now. All right, so we've got blink, teleport, fire, and fire armor are all manual and all in order. Deterministic. All right, that should, let's see how that goes. Set a breakpoint here first. Oh, nice. Got it in time. All right. Dungeon goal items. First round, blink, teleport, fire armor. Nice. And then we've got secondary, these are randomized. Now we've got glove, boots, and the chip. Alt dungeons. Ending item done. Cool. Does look good. Okay, next up, now that that's that way, we've got dungeon 6, 7, or 8 that the fire dungeon could be. So I'm going to manually set it that way. It's not random. After it places all these styles initially. Oh, wait, hold on. I need to check one thing. Want to see this one. There's a certain dungeon which looks ugly to me, and I want to make sure and note which one it is. Yeah, this one. This color right here does not mix with another color. This yellow color especially is really ugly to me. So I need to work on it. Something wrong with that. Which is style? What style is that? Style, style, style. C4. Hark 3. It's the last Hark one. It is. All right, Hark 3. I gotta remember. Okay, so I'm taking out fire there. I'm randomizing these styles. And then I've got a concrete style. Ooh, I wish I had a random number at this point. So eventually it'll look something like this. Style keys like 6, 7, or 8. We'll just do 6 for now. Equals fire 1. Hell, maybe I'll just leave it like that for now. Because I do have a lot of other work that I'll have to do eventually to be like, once I have the like the ice, I think I am going to do elemental dungeons. So there'll be a fire dungeon, ice dungeon, acid dungeon, fear dungeon, lightning dungeon. And I got bosses in mind for all those too. So that should be pretty nice to have a theme for all the themes. And then once I get to that point, that's going to make it a lot more clear how I should randomize this. So for now, I'm just going to put dungeon 6 as fire. And that'll change like next week when I have the ice dungeon or whatever finished. Or next 10 days, 2 weeks, something like that. Okay, let's see if that works. a Ben Franklin joke. I love it. The Lightning Dungeon boss. What if the Lightning Dungeon boss is Ben Franklin? And he's got a kite, of course. The kite is his weapon. Wow, it's so bright in here now that the bloom shader goes off a lot. Oh, wait a minute. That's because the heat and everything. Oh, I need to take away the shad. Let's check Shadrach's tier. Make sure it's being worked. Dun dun dun. Zyger is like. Failed fish. Yeah, so if I didn't have fire armor, let's make sure it still works. The entrance is missing, of course. That needs to be fixed. We need some elevator here. Ooh, what happened to this door? Oh, the doors are weird because I don't have the wall set up yet. Yeah, so now that I'm in this hot room, player starts getting hurt. Getting hurt. Let's make sure that I can go to dungeon 5, get the fire armor, and then go to dungeon 6. Just make sure that little loop of gameplay works. So I'm in dungeon 5. Oh, check it. It's like, oops. It blooms the text too. So look at this text down here. It's all bloomed out. Salad dogs! It's about time salad dogs won the free parking. Oh, is there sound? Rigged. He always wins. I like it when you win. That's the funniest to me. Yeah. Other boys, Salad Dongs. You got a magical attraction. Bafu loves you. Bafu is sucking up. Is it just hot today? Why is my CPU fan going? Sorry, obligatory. Let's check the CPU fan moment. Yeah. I guess I'll take off. What a moment. You see that? Did you guys see that? Does everybody see what just happened? That was quite a gift. Oh yeah, dungeon 5. Oh, here we go. Yes, nice. Here's Shadrach's tier. I'll save it right here. Shadrach's tier. This needs to be a different color. Constance. Fire armor is the color of ice. Look at that, Zyger. Oh, that was swift. Swift execution right there, Zyger. Man, you didn't even hesitate. I love it. I love it when no people don't hesitate. It's so great. Congratulations, Zyger. Oh, Boogie's giving you the slow clap. Nice, man. So email me. Email me, and I will get back to you after the stream. Send you your key. Do you have a key already? If you do, you got multiple keys. You can give it to anybody you want. Do whatever you need. Here's my email. Probably have my email already, but I'll just type it in anyways. It's nat@wizardfoo. nat@wizardfoo.com. Just email me. I'll send you the key after the stream. Congratulations. Okay, so if I pick up this, Oh, you bought one. Oh, thank you. Appreciated. Much appreciated. Shadrach's tier protects the wearer from ambient heat damage. Bam! Alright. So I need to go to dungeon 6. Which is where, man? Where is dungeon 6? There it is! It's all the way across the whole world. I think I got god mode. So I am gonna add a teleport. I think I'm gonna add some way that you can use the teleport cube to warp to certain places in the overworld. Perhaps the refills. This is dungeon 6? This looks like dungeon 2. Oh, that was really weird. So I got the entrance is all broken in this dungeon, but I think what that means is I have Shadrach's tier. I'm here in this dungeon, and if I go in this fiery room, I should not take ambient damage. Good. All right, we just confirmed that that loop works all right, and I got an idea to make it not so gloomy in this roomy. Less bloom in this room. Thank you. Thank you very much. The atmosphere. There's an Nim's atmosphere. The atmosphere needs to render into the last camera flag. So that'll make it so it doesn't bloom, and it blooms before it does the atmosphere. So yeah, so that should look better. Save the bloom for the little tiny things. Just a few pixels here and there need to be bloomed. Any more than that, it just starts looking weird. All right, it didn't. Oh, it saved me way back there. All right, whatever. Put me back. Dungeon 6. Nice, cool. Now we've got a better bloom again. So it's like how it was. Yes, it looks really good. Awesome. So we're rocking it here in the fire dungeon. Let's make, let's cross off that few things off the list so far. Jeez, it really is just a hot day. Man, makes me want to go get an ice pack for the computer, but I don't have any ice packs. Yeah, it's just the game. The game's not as efficient as it used to be. With all these new shaders. Okay, that's one thing off the list. Two things maybe. Fire armor replacement, that's done. Fire dungeon is guaranteed, but the fire boss needs to be in the fire dungeon. So, okay, I know how to do this. If we were to go to this dungeon's boss, it would probably be the wrong boss. Unless we just got lucky. So let's make sure that the fire boss appears here. Hey, what's up, Elite SCB? I know, right? Coco City X and Bulkhead or something. Is this to the right or the left? Yes, inside the freezer. You're like, no, not really. Oh, wait, we got lucky. It really was the fire boss. But let's guarantee it, make sure that's gonna work in the future. And my plan for guaranteeing it is to add a new type of match word for... Yeah, the fire boss? Oh, nice. I get the joke. Cool boss. Nice one. So yeah, the fire boss is going to be style 7. So you can so a foe type can be matched to. Ooh, wait, no, that's not right, huh? Style, I think I already have a style word. So I might need to make this style car. Style character. In the loading code, I set the file size plus one. Oh. Does taking away the one help? Does it fix it? Ooh, that one styles. So I guess I could have style car. But I think style car is a more descriptive word, so I'll keep that. The only comment I have about it, to do investigate why I have to add one to the sites. I have a comment like that too somewhere in Songbringer. It embarrasses me every time I look at it. Is C sharp an ideal choice if you want to make desktop software, not so much video games? It is if you want to make Windows software. If you want to make cross-platform software, not so much. If you want to do cross-platform software, you need a more of a cross-platform friendly language like C++ or C. Really, those are the two most cross-platforming languages out there. Well, unless you want to count Java. Java is also pretty ideal for making cross-platform. Yeah, I think your choices would probably be more like C, C++, or Java. Oh, so you can use C Sharp and Xamarin Studio? Does that all work though? Oh, Xamarin's commercial? I didn't know Xamarin was commercial. I don't know. I'll let the guys that know the C Sharp better than I do to the talking here. Because I don't really know. I'm talking out my ass. Don't really know that much about C Sharp. Has Z range, styles. Style car. Yeah, we could do a style character. If this character's 0, then it doesn't have one. Yeah, okay. Car. Style car. Do this. Oh. Okay, world matcher, you need. Oh, styles, where does that go in the order? Set item. Stock car 0 by default. This just belongs up at the top. Call it stock car 0 there. We need to parse it. Huh. Oh, yeah. Okay, so the string is going to be leaf get child style car. Avoid writing cross-platform. Instead, just make a clear delineation between. Yeah. So you really do have to like think about cross-platform, but you don't necessarily write any. platform-specific code until you need to. Yeah. Man, this is easy enough. Style car equals stir zero. Easy, man. Okay, so that's gonna load the style car, and then when it's going to match world matcher. Wait, I guess I don't want to use that anywhere except for, except for when it's needed. But get possible foes might be one. Oh, yeah, it is. Yeah, you can use DLLs on Mac, but they're not called DLLs. They're called dylibs. It's essentially the same concept. I prefer not to use DLLs or dylabs as much as possible. I like statically linking myself because I've always found that dynamically loaded libraries can get overwritten, you know, and then you're like, God damn it, somebody on this computer overwrote their DLL or some virus overwrote their DLL or whatever, and then, Good IDE for Java. We were just talking about this yesterday. There's Eclipse, which has gotten a lot better, it seems like. And then there's IntelliJ and some other good ones. Boogie says this one doesn't exist. Stock cars. Area. Is it get... Area get style car? No, it's world get style car, which is this. This is already that, but well, p.z. There. Now, match the style car. Yeah, there's those. Hey, what's up, Sully? Welcome. This game engine I'm using is called Cocos 2DX. Huh. That would be crazy. I think there's a lot of Windows-specific code, though, that goes into DLLs. Like, the way it wraps them and stuff. So, right, yeah. Write code twice for that? I'm not sure how. I wasn't quite following that. Hey, Aragon, what's up, Aragon? Welcome, welcome. I haven't seen you on here in a minute. All right, so if this foe.stylecar is greater than zero, or not equal to zero, I guess it's a character, an unsigned car. This should be an unsigned car. But whatever. All right, so if this foe type is trying to match a style car and the style character doesn't match, then continue. So we can't match unless we match the style car. And this is really only used here, so I think that's all we need to do. You're learning Game Maker? Cool, man. I highly recommend that, especially for beginners. I recommend looking at learning a lot about every part of game development, including programming, including art and making art, including making sound and music, including writing, including good design, and also including some story writing as well. And some business, if you can throw that in there. Try and learn about all five or six of those things. And especially when you're first starting out in game development, because then you kind of get a feel for all those areas and whether you're the kind of person that wants to do all those things yourself or whether you're the kind of person that wants to find a team that can help you do the things that you don't yet know how to do, or you just feel like you're the kind of person you want that kind of help and you want to be a part of a team or whatever. So basically, Game Maker is a really nice thing that can give you that overview pretty quickly. Yes, yes. If it's not fun, you nice, Racket. Nice, nice. So let's see if that worked. If it did work, then we still have the fire boss here in this dungeon. All right, good. Still got him here. So I guess we need a world where he wouldn't. Yeah, so we need a. I need a different world, Z. I'm gonna comment this out. This is what I just wrote. Get that out of there. And then we need to go do a different mega seed so I can break the fire boss. It's not gonna be the fire boss here in this dungeon. Yes, right on. Nice. Oh, I'm so glad you're doing art, code, and music all at once. That's great. Trying to get some business in there too. And some story writing and design. Perfect, here's a great example. This is World Seed Relics, and the random boss it chose for this one is the Blob Boss. So we want this to always be the Fire Boss. Using data. So the data I've set up is all set up. I just need to turn on this match style car thing. And let's make sure that this data is coming out right. Also, now I know I added one of the... Yes, you figured it out! I was using it for loading shader source, and the shaders don't compile properly without it. Really? Oh. Uh-huh, when they're loaded from disk, isn't loading the mold byte. Yeah. Yeah. Nice. Glad you got that figured out. No, man, you're not interrupting. Feel free to talk all you want, chat all you want. I'm here for you guys. I'm here to just chill, man, and chat and have fun and share the process of game development. And I like meeting new people and stuff. So I'm, you know, so and ask questions all you want, and don't feel like you're interrupting. And yeah, and please share your progress as you're learning. Feel free to come back and say hi and show me what you made. You know, share your screenshots of stuff you're making or whatever. What's up, baby? How are you? Oh, yeah, right. Nice, Ragan. Nice. Thanks, Boogie. So, what's up with this, style? No, wait. Yeah, so they put the fire boss in Dungeon 5 or whatever. Let's actually look at where to put all these fire bosses. Fire boss, Dungeon 3. 5, 7. Yes, exactly. That's how I do it. I do my regular work all day, and then I take 2 hours a day and do this live stream. Nice, right on, Silly. So that was commented. Oh, that didn't work, did it? Or was that the old... Right on. Okay, so put the fire boss there. And I think, hopefully that was the old, so if I do another copy here and search for the fire boss again, we just have him at 6. Right on. Nice. Cool. That works. Okay. Is there anything else I should do to confirm that that worked really well? Because this is fundamental. Super fundamental. Right? Time goes fast. Time, it got time. I feel like time goes fast every day, but overall, it doesn't move as fast as you think. Right? Time's a tricky ass thing, isn't it? You know what? I think that works. My programmer instinct says that's all right. So I'm gonna check it in. I can always fix it later if there is something super da super duper wrong with it. Oh, you know what? Here, I'll just confirm it by commenting that out. Let's change the data a little bit. So if I don't have that style card, I can throw the fire boss anywhere and we'll have the same kind of thing again, probably. Yeah, so we got that blob boss again, and fire boss is 3, 5, 7, 9 too. Okay, so there we go, fire dungeon. Oh, let's see one more check. If I do the style car of 1, that would be. Let's see where he puts it. It should put it for every single one of those one styles. So there should be a lot of these bosses. Yeah, so I put it for 3. Oh, I did the same. 3 and 5. Are these the only ones that had style 1? Let's see. Style. Dungeon 1. Oh, it does the drop boss. 3, 4. Oh, because it can't repeat. Okay, so that does make sense. So why I would have put it for 5 there, 3 there, and then 1 is always the draw boss. Okay, that's good. So that she needs to be stock car 7. That's basically making dungeon style 7, always, which is the fire dungeon, always has the fire boss. My full-time job, you could call it that, yes. Yep. I kind of earned this job by doing a Kickstarter and building up this stream. I started this video game, Sully, in November of 2014 and with 0 followers on Twitter, 0 followers on Twitch. No following whatsoever, and I built it up for about 4 months until it was like good enough to do a kick, barely good enough to do a Kickstarter, and got some funds that way. So that's how it became a full-time job for me, if you could call it that. I don't really like calling game development a job because it's way more than that for me. It's more of a passion project. I never consider it work. I call it work sometimes because I try and relate to people, and that's how people always talk. They're like, I got to go to work, or I got more work to do tonight, and stuff like that. But to me, it's not really work. Okay, so I can check that in. Style characters. Fire boss is guaranteed to be in the fire dungeon. I can get rid of that there. Anims. Yes, yeah, you can totally. Yep. Totally. And you get a copy of the game that way too. But don't feel like you have to. It's not like, just being here on the stream, don't feel obligated at all. If you want to pre-order the game and it looks good to you, please, by all means. Right. Okay, so we changed the color. I changed the color of the fire armor, so it's blue. Took out fire 1 from the randomized styles, made it a concrete hard-coded style for now. Primary goal items are now not randomized, so they can just be a simple list here, which is blink, teleport, fire armor. Secondary goal items are randomized. The gate items were rearranged a little bit for the shield. Secret there. Style car gets set to zero. Style car gets parsed. And then gets used in the foes. When it's placing all the foes in the world, including the bosses, it checks the style car. And if it doesn't have, if it does have a style car and it's not matching, then it doesn't use it. That type of foe. So, all right, that's cool. Check this all in. This is the fire boss. Always goes in the fire dungeon. Cool, right on. Okay, so that's another one. Cross out the list. Oh! Bam! Almost sub 40 cards now. Okay, so the next thing, I want the fire spawning with random positions and randomized animations. So the good thing, we're already here on this point with the fire boss. Because this is where we need to be to make these random fire. Fire's a little more random looking. So let me get the fire boss up here. And he'll spawn a bunch of fire by doing his fire attacks and his trails and stuff like that. And I'll make all the positions of the fire more random. So it'll randomize the positions. And I also want to randomize the frames. So every time it does an animation of fire, it will do it'll randomize the order of the frames. But I think the positions and a little bit of scaling too for this fire will really, really help with me. Okay, so I'm just trying to think about how. Yeah, Fire Wizard, he's cool. He's super cool. He's got a sweet punch, too. So I don't think you saw the punch because I was dodging him. But, like, watch this punch. It's so great. I know you guys are watching on the stream. You're only seeing this at 15 frames a second, so it looks a hell of a lot better at 60. But see there? He punched Jib. Here, I'll stand right in his way so he punches me. Boom! Sucker punch! I love this guy. He's got a lot of hit points too. He's pretty rad. So, okay. There's two ways I can make the positions of the fire a little bit more random. One would be to change the offset of its sprite, but that would also have to change its children. So really it's to just change the position. Of course that would be better too. KO, totally. You got knocked out. This is Mike Tyson's Super Punch Out, but just in a different, you know, it's just a little different. We've remixed Mike Tyson's Super Punch Out a little bit here. So the tricky thing is the way the fire is spawned right now. The fire boss, he goes and spawns a bunch of fire. Whenever he's walking around or he's flying around, he spawns fire. But he can also spawn a fire trail or launch a fire trail, which spawns a bunch of fire. So there's a lot of ways that fire can get spawned. And if I were to throw all this randomizing the position code in where it actually gets spawned, then I have to do it for every one of those places, which sucks because that'll become quickly... what's the word? Coupled. It'll become quickly coupled, not cohesive code. So I want to write cohesive code, which means in this instance, I actually should put this, what will seem kind of like a janky move here. I'm going to randomize the position and the scale of this sprite. All right, so besides trying to do it right, I'm just going to do it first. That's like kind of a common theme in my programming lately, last 5 years or so. I always do things rather than trying to think about how to do them too long. Yes, the fire exists as its own object. Yep, everything in the game is an entity. It's using an entity component system, something you should look into at some point. Probably not now if you're just beginning game development. But at some point, you should understand what an entity component system is. But not now. You don't really need to know what that is now. Yeah, so let's just do this the janky way first. An AI system, when it spawns some fire, does the fireboss determine the fire object's variables? No, not all of them. That was a good question because that's very appropriate to what I was just saying there. But see, let me try and show you an example of how this guy's AI works. Where is he? Drop fire. There it is. So this is his sequence. Whenever he's moving around, he spawns fire. So essentially none of the variables for fire are getting set by the fire boss at this point. It's just the fire itself, the fire entity here, has all its own variables. All this is render components, input component, collision, and all that. So yeah, most of its variables are there. So I guess the fire itself could offset its position a little if it wanted. Yeah, you made it in any component system, and it's delish. Right on, Aragon. Right on. Yep. Any foo. Any foo. I made it for this game and shared it with GitHub, with the world. It's all free. It's MIT license. Okay, yeah, so back in AI system. This is the janky method. Spawns. So I know what kind of entity it's spawning here. And this is the janky part. Stir val 0 is fire. Gonna offset the position a little. What determines the position of the fire? The fire boss determines it. Yeah, Java. Java's got its own entity component system somebody wrote though. What's it called? Artemis. There's an entity component system called Artemis, but I recommend writing your own anyways. I would definitely write your own ECS if you can. So let's try, first of all, I'll randomize the scale a little bit. So spawned dot, actually this needs to be for all children and self. And we just float scale. Scale is DRAND F01, actually 1.0 minus something. Like maybe how much could possibly be taken away? Maybe a quarter of the scale can be taken away. So there. Kit for all children and self on the entities render.sprite recursive true function that takes capture the scale, take the node. And so for all these, we're just going n.set scale, n.get scale times scale. So there, that should randomize the scale of all the fire. Let's see if it worked. Yeah, totally fits the game more if you make your own. Totally. Nice, man. I'm excited for you. Okay, cool. So I'm seeing that a few of these fire sprites are smaller now. That's good. I'm gonna exaggerate the effect a little bit here and make this look like more. So if we did 1.25 minus 0.5, that'll make some of the fires bigger and some of the fires smaller. Lot of those are bigger. Nice. This is actually looking pretty good. I like those scales. The 1.25 does kind of mean, I didn't draw that art at that resolution, but it still kind of looks good that way. Thanks to the frame buffers. All right, so we've got some randomized scales, randomized position a little bit. And drandf times 4, maybe. Oh, this is an E. This is spawned. Spawned. I think this should be 3. So let's try that out. Let's exaggerate the effect at first. Let's do like 8 and 6. Let's make sure this is working. And then dial it in, make it look real good. Got the last position. So you see how the fires are moving? It's because it's interpolating the position from the position to the last position each tick. So it needs to set its last position as well. Spawn dot position dot last pause equals spawn position. Where's the autocomplete when you need it? I had to type all of that. You guys see that? It's crying shame. Nice. Show it when it's not broken. You're working on the GUI. Nice, a library, J panels. Oh yeah, cool man. Sounds like a fun adventure. What kind of game are you writing? Nice, that was way better. Okay, you can see that the effect is maybe a little much, maybe not. This definitely looks a lot more random. Everywhere he's dropping the fire is like sometimes, yeah, it's a little bit too much. So let's go with, the X was pretty good actually. But I think it could come in a little, maybe 6 and 4 here. Maybe 6, and then this is the move system. Y factor, which is the square root of 2. Nice, yeah, that looks a little bit better. So now when he's moving in a straight line, the fire is not quite as, good. Cool, we got randomized fire positions and scales. This is looking great. Next up is to work on the randomizing the animation. So that one piece of fire never ever runs the same animation twice. Yeah, totally. He's looking more chaotic, huh? A town game. Town game, cool. Unique with no grid system. Whoa. Nice, man. I like your unique twist, and I think you're setting yourself up for success there with that unique twist. It seems like a lot of people that start off game projects or whatever, you know, and they're not learning, right? If you're beyond learning games and you're ready to write a game and produce it, sell it, or do whatever, a lot of times they'll take an existing concept and just do it and not really add much twists to it. So I like that you're adding a twist. That really is cool. Yeah, thanks, Boogie. Yeah, he's turning out pretty good, right? And it's really pumping me up for the next bosses too. So I got some things in mind for the ice boss, the acid boss, the lightning boss, the very end boss. I can't wait to show off what I got for the very end boss. That guy's so awesome. All right, this is where to check in. Get this checked in. Randomize fire spawn positions and scales. All right. I almost don't even need to randomize the frames anymore. But I'm gonna try it. In the render system, there's a function that animates a frame of an entity. This is manual animation. I'm not using Cocos 2DX's animation. I use my own because it's way more rock solid that way. Right? Yeah, yeah. Here we go. So it's repeating the animation. This is once again, this is gonna be some janky code here at first, but I'm gonna make this more rock solid in the end by using a flag. So, but I don't want to go and change my headers until I have to. So the first thing I'm doing here is just the same kind of thing I just did over there in that other bit of code. I'm going erender.animation is, oh wait, this is where I need to check the profile. So yeah, profile. Get title is fire. This is going to be a flag, not like this, but this is where I would try out randomizing the fire flames, the fire. Just the best place to probably do this is not here, but at like a nice place on the overworld, the very beginning perhaps. So we can see just like two pieces of flames, watch those two flames and make sure they don't ever repeat or whatever, because we're going to randomize them now. Oh, there you go, if it turns out. Do you ever use placeholders when making a game to flesh out the design and then go back and replace the placeholders? Yes, totally. Are you to build it completely from start to finish without dealing with placeholders? No, totally. The thing about game development is, or at least maybe in my experience, maybe this is just my experience with game development, but I've never ever written a game that I started out thinking of. I mean, what I'm trying to say by that is, at the very beginning of your project, you always have some things in mind of where you kind of want things to go with this game, whatever you're working on in general, right? You gotta, okay, I wanna make a 3D game, I wanna make a Zelda-like game or whatever. Whatever you have some general things in mind, but you also have some specific things in your head that you like, okay, I kinda want it to look like that. I kind of want the characters to move like this. And then as you go on in your project, 6 months goes by and your game looks, in general, your game is still the same thing that you started out making, but it's so much different than you ever thought it could be. You know what I mean? That's at least how it works for me. Like, it's just iterative to design. You know, every day the design changes a little bit. The art changes a little bit. It's like iterative game development. Every day it gets a little bit better. It changes a little bit. So what I started out designing a year and a half ago with this game is, like I said, it's not really, I never could have thought it out. If I had tried to write a design document and stick to that stupid design document, I would have killed all of my creative momentum in the project. So I highly recommend using things like placeholders, because you never know when you're going to want to change that completely. You know, you just try out the placeholders to see if it's fun. You know what I mean? Throw in the placeholders because you need to see how big something should be. Use placeholders as often as you can because it just helps you it helps you play with the design without having to commit to a certain aesthetic or art or whatever that you're going to waste time on. If you had gone and written your whole thing with that certain aesthetic or design in mind, you would have locked yourself into that and you would be blocking your creativity later on. Oh, file size. Nice. Oh, it's the text, huh? Oh. Yeah, you're welcome, guys. Right, that was Braid. Oh my god, that's funny. It's even got like a Mario-like character. Oh, that's funny. Yeah, so don't waste your own time. That's what I'm trying to say there. Don't waste your own time by trying to draw your art perfectly at first, because it's going to change. Everything in your game is going to change over time, unless you work totally differently. Oh, they do? Yeah, that's a good movie. If you haven't seen that indie game, the movie. We already have the animation, so an M, get frames. I'm gonna see if I can randomize frames. I'm not sure if this is possible, because it returns a Cocos 2DX vector. I guess you can set frames. Oh, great. So if I'm making a, I am, I'm making a copy there of the vector. So I'm copying out this vector. If I rearrange it now, and then set it again, and then set frames. I'll just randomize them. We'll go for int I equals 0. I is less than the size of these frames. And for each element, we'll just swap it with the random other element. So this is swap. Swap frames I. Oh, this should be fr this is same frames dot size. Oh no, yeah, this is fine. Swap frames I with frames drand unsigned mod is going to be frames.size. So we'll do an int max here, constant max. Frames.size. Loop over the max. Drand max. Here we go. It's not liking this. Oh, this thing is crazy about how it does this. Yeah, so I can't use swap because of the way Cocos 2DX designed their stupid vector. It's really a horribly written vector class. I don't know why they wouldn't. They've got all this usage of regular vectors, a regular STL vector, and then they go ahead and write their own vector, and it doesn't have it like nearly the features it needs. Don't know why they would do that. Why don't they just, if they're already using vectors, why don't they just use the vectors? I think they're trying to go for a little more speed or something. Anyways, okay, I just want to swap those two frames. So what can you do with frames? Can you set? You can do at. Oh my God, you can swap. It actually has a swap method. No, this can't be right. That's not right. Okay, we need to get dive into the Cocos 2DX stuff. Yeah, this is C++. Yeah. Yep, this engine's called Cocos 2DX. The language I'm using is C++. And yeah. So you can do an op equals, but that's for the whole vector. Get reserve capacity. I want index, find, at, front, back, get random object, contains equals pushback, insert. Pop back array, swap, you can swap. Very nice. Get index, standard swap data. All right, cool. That's gonna work. Nice. Good job, CocoStudioX. Frames.swap. I and DRAND. Yeah. Yeah, so I recommend you stick with GameMaker for a minute until you kind of get, well, maybe you're ready. I don't know, whenever you're ready. You know, I would recommend learning C first. Because it'll teach you more of the basics. And then C++ is basically just an extension of C. So once you've learned C, you really have mastered a lot of C++. You're right. Really, C++ is just kind of like a little bit extra compared to C. And C will also teach you the basics of a lot of other programming languages. It'll teach you things that are very important to know, too, like pointers. And so, yeah, I would recommend C. Okay, I don't know if this will work or not, but let's hope it does. So I'm gonna slow down time and look at these. Yeah, that's not working. It's somehow synced them up that now they're using exactly the same animation, which might basically just mean that every time one of them stops, it's randomizing the frames for all of them. That's probably what's going on. Which would mean, how would I actually go about randomizing the frames if it's using the same animation for everybody? I guess I would have to create a new animation. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, I think it's hard to tell what's actually going on here. I guess I should verify if this is even getting to that code. Good, all right, so I looped through one of the fire animations frames already. Got the frames. It has six of them. And then for each one of those, it's going to swap them randomly. Can we see some pointers here? Yeah. Okay, cool. I saw it swap. All right, good. It is swapping nicely. Set frames. Yeah, I think this is basically, it's affecting a single animation that's used by every single fire. So that's why it's not working. Yeah, oh, agreed with you there, Salad Dongs. I also find a lot of C++ to be stuff you don't need. Uh-huh. Right, nice, nice. Yeah. I like C, the more mature I get as a programmer, I like C more and more myself too. And it's because the simplicity of structs and the simplicity of procedures and putting the right focus on the right types of things, just like the article you sent me talks about with the semantically compressing your code. You know, that was a great article. I realize I've kind of coded that way a long time, but it's a good way to think about it, semantic compression. This makes sense, thinking about it like that. All right, Sully. Cheers, man. Thanks, man. I appreciate it. So I think if I want to randomize these frames, I think the best thing to do is actually to randomize them before I ever use them. And then there will be like three or four of the same exact animation. And whenever it does a get animation, it'll choose one at random, basically, but that's it'll need to actually use a different key. So, yeah, I can't spend any more time on this today. I'm gonna cut this one. This is taking too much time. This is not turning out to be rewarding enough to actually, do anything. So if I take that out and then. I shouldn't have changed any code at this point. And if I go back and play this, it shouldn't look that bad. Jonah, nice. Yeah. Totally, right? Yeah, it also keeps you from trying to plan things too much, which is a big part of programming. Nice, Ragan. Yeah, so both these flames are also kind of in sync, but if you know, most people are probably not going to notice. So, okay, onward, onward, onward. I'm going to call this one done. Random positions and scales. Who cares about the animations at this point? Okay, I want the fireballs to explode into fire now. Oh, you're jealous. You're trying to plan it out with UML? No way. No way. Yeah. Rigged. It's all rigged. He shoots fireballs still, but he doesn't shoot fireballs as often as he. I guess I'll turn off all of his advanced awesomeness here for a minute. So just focus on his fireball attack so we can make these fireballs explode into fiery fireness. Who wrote this bot? Clearly. So he can still leave fire, but I don't want him to spawn the spiders for a moment. Turn this one off and turn off the shoot two, which is the trail. So just has this he just has this shoot. So now he's just gonna do fireballs. Or leave his fiery trail. Okay, let's make him do it more. This is if RAND 1.0, let's do RAND 0.1. Cool. Okay, so he's dropping fireballs. And all I want to do now is just make the fireball so it drops a different kind of thing. Right now it does this small explosion. I'm gonna do a fire explosion entity. So data, I think it's a weapon. Small explosion. So I'm copying small explosion into fire explosion. And this thing will have a different color and will also light things on fire. and perhaps even leave some fire itself. All right, Boogie. We'll see you, man. We'll be on our best behavior, I promise. So fireball, instead of dropping a small explosion, it's going to do a fire explosion. Can't promise anything. Fire explosion. Boom. Okay, now I need to make sure that everywhere else in the small explosion. Whoops. Small explosion with two L's. So small explosion is going to need a color. Hey, thanks for the follow. Okay, so this takes a color now, and we don't need call. Set color, color. Circle as well probably needs to be based on color, perhaps desaturated or something, maybe. Flicker as well here, color, color. So the boss explosions, those are all white. Regular small explosion is white. Fire explosion is kind of orange though. What kind of upsides are there to using header classes? What's a header class? Oh, you mean just headers in general, header files? There's really no advantage from a programmer's perspective to using header files. In fact, if your language does not have header files, more power to you, man, seriously. C++ is ancient in the way that it does header files. It sucks, actually. Header files are horrible. They really suck for programmers. But for the advantage is for the compiler. The compiler knows what everything... It's a lot simpler for the compiler to compile if it has all the header details. So really, headers are just were written for compilers, and they're basically no good for programmers, in my opinion. Let's make this orange. Yeah, I think this one's orange here. Yeah, you'd think it's overall it's quicker compiling, but it's not necessarily even quicker compiling. It's just that it can compile. It's kind of written in a base. Yeah, exactly. Saladongs. It's a vestige of the old days, man. It's not worth it. It's not worth it anymore. They should have gotten rid of header files a long time ago. And in fact, they've been trying. There's a thing called modules, which they're doing with Objective-C, which are a lot better than headers. And they tried to make, or at least Clang, at least Clang has this ability to use modules even for C++, but there's actually a great video on it. On the he talks about modules and all that. Oh, right, if you're using a Unity build, that's a good point. Okay, so now we should have a fire explosion. Let's make sure the fire explosion has a collision category, shot foe, and fire so it can light stuff on fire, including like the player. So now if we get hit by a fireball, it should also leave some fire on us and it should be orange. Cool. So I saw that the small explosion was orange. That's good. Let's see if we get hit by. Yeah, nice. See, I got some fire spawned on me. Oh, he's getting hit by his own fire. Oh, that might be because. Shot bow flag or whatever. Wow. Blur shader turned out really cool there. It's kind of working. It's kind of working, but it's kind of a flaw that when he steps on it, he shouldn't be hurt by fire. Yeah, Ragan, he's talking about Unity builds, not necessarily Unity the engine. Yeah, the fires are looking good, huh? So the fire boss, does he have the mask? So he can be hurt by fire. See, this is weird. He can't even be hurt by fire. Oh, but he can be hurt by. What? What entity is that? Let's find out. When it spawns fire, from a collision, that's from a health system, apply elements. Yep. I know what you're talking about with the Unity build. Do you call it a Unity build? Or do you call it stub? There's another word for it too, some people have been using. It's one of those words that like it's often changed into a different word or phrase. Is an interface the same as the header file? Technically, you're talking about the interface as far as Objective-C goes, right? Yeah, if you're talking about Objective-C interfaces, yes, it's basically the same thing, but not really, not necessarily. You're the wording there is different. So you're saying is an interface the same as a header file? Not necessarily. It is the same as a header of a class, though. You know what I mean? The header file can be used or not used in C++. You don't necessarily need a header file if you can put everything in the same CPP file. So, but yeah, and it technically an interface is the same thing. Oh, cool. Oh, you're talking about Java? Oh. Okay, I don't even know what Java interfaces are at all. I don't know. Here, create a damaging fire entity. Create fire. Shot neutral. Okay. So whenever a piece of fire is created, it creates with shot neutral. I don't think that's a good idea. I think this should be shot foe if it's a foe, and shot friend if it's a if that entity is a friend. No, that wouldn't work either, because that way, if the hero got hurt with fire, they would spawn a fire entity with shot friend, and therefore the fire boss would be hurt by it. So shot neutral is actually the right way to go here, and then just making sure that the fire boss cannot be hurt by shot neutral. Let's see that now. Interface is an actual construct in the Java language. Okay, hit that fire. Oh, yep, I think he got over it. He didn't get hurt by it, so here we go. We've got fireballs that are creating fire. I got an idea. Let's add some more fire. I know Jib gets hit all the time. He's like a little punching bag. He can be local co-op though. In local co-op mode, you can play as Jib if you're player two. So you can dodge fire, you can dodge stuff a lot better if you have a human player that's doing that, you know. And he has a little weapon. He has like a little he can knock back, and he can has an elemental attack too with that knockback thing. Right, when it does the fire explosion, here it is. Also do an anims fire. I think it's called fire explosion. Yeah. See what that looks like. Yep, local co-op. Nice, you see that? Oh, that was pretty cool. When the fireball explodes, it launched all those. That's awesome. But a little too much duration. That was a 1 second duration. Let's do like a half second duration to max. So slow. Flip it down to like 0.1. We from Java? Yeah. Okay. That duration does work. Yeah, I'm using A star. Yep, it's a great simple algorithm. A star is awesome. And if you need to learn how to do A-Star, there's a great article out there by Red Blob. Okay, this is not fast enough for me. There needs to be some kind of speed here. You're out of the durations, it's not really working with the delay per. Ah, see, there's the fall duration. What if fall duration is duration times 0.68? Yeah, great algorithm, right? Totally. A-star is nice. Yep. Yeah, you're right. It's so universal. You can use it once you've written it, and you kind of have like a class dedicated to it. It's awesome. You can do whatever you want at that point. Yeah, those are moving too fast now. Okay, so I have fall duration of 0.618 before. I want to look at all the places I'm using fire explosion already and see how I can make the math work without changing the header file, because I'm tired of recompiling today. This is fire duration is 0.05. This is an AoE effect. Oh, this is Jib. Jib does a little one. Wow. Here's the one that matters, though. This one is 3 seconds for the fire bomb. Which means if I use the, if I take that math and I want it to come out to be, if the fall duration is supposed to be 0.618 based on the assumption that fire explosions are usually around, or they used to be around 3 seconds, that's 0.618 over 3 seconds, it's 0.206 times the regular duration. That will give you a fall duration that's appropriate based on your duration. So hopefully that looks better. And then the fire bomb, which I should give the player, is exactly the same. Turn off the fear bomb. Oh, it's still on. But it's not looking good yet with, where's this guy at? Where are you at? Forget which one you were. There we go. That's a half second. Let's try a whole second now. That'll give you a fall duration of 0.206. Maybe it should be clamped. Yeah, it needs to be clamped. Maybe duration times a half. Let's do 1.618 between 0, well, 0 point fall duration, maybe Oh yeah, this is where the bottom should be 0.618. And the top, 2 seconds is gonna be way too long, so we'll do that. So if I'm passing in a half second, that means the fall for the whole duration, and that's the fall duration is 0.618. Still not right. Oh, the top needs to be 0.618 and the bottom needs to be 0.1 or so. So that gives me, if the regular duration was 3 seconds, 3 times 0.618 is going to be like 1.6 or 7 or so. And then that gets clamped to be 0.618 max. And then for the other animation, it should look all right. Let's see. Getting better. Now its time can come down, maybe start with around 2/3 of a second. Maybe less height too. I probably should just make this manual and have, yeah, okay, I just did all that just to try and not have to recompile, but now I've realized I need to recompile. Oh well. So fire explosions are going to have a duration and also a fall duration. Wow, my computer sounds like it's about to explode. So this fall duration call, we'll use the old default. This one, though, needs like a really tiny overall duration, and then this around the same fall duration. All right, so I'm getting close to being done with today's stream. I'm just gonna finish up testing with this, get this fire explosion to look cool when the fireball hits, and then I'll clean it up, check it in, and check one more thing off my Trello list, and that'll be it for today's stream. So probably about 5 more minutes. My computer sounds like it's about to explode, so it needs a break. I need a break. It only breaks on the house, breaks it all around. You need a break? Take a break. Here's a break. Have a break. Break it in half. Break it. Give it to a friend. Frank can have half. You can have half. Double the break. W fun. Break dance. Why not? Everybody break dance. What do they call that? The sixth thing? The 6 point? Congratulations, mutinous. Okay, I need to let this get back to tranquilo. Come on. Cool yourself off, laptop. I know it's a hot day. I know you're a MacBook Pro and you overheat like it's it's nothing. Hey, what's up, good Paul? Okay, I think it's good enough. Okay, so we should still have the firebomb looking good, and now we should have these. Yeah, oh yeah, I remember now. Paul Six, right. What's up, Paul Six? Yeah, yeah, nice. And if I launch a firebomb... Still good? Cool. Alright, now we can dial this in a little bit more. I think the height needs to be coming down. The fall duration's pretty good. Overall duration, maybe a tad less. Oh, you gave your points to Bodfu. That's so nice of you. Bodfu takes his points and gives them to other people too. It's a circle of points. Should fall a little faster, and maybe a little less of them. Hey, see you, Zanger. Later, man. Have a good one, Zanger. Yeah, this is the fire dungeon. It has a fire on it the whole time. It is super bright, but that's because you're in a really hot place. Oh, cool. That does look a little bit better. So that's just a little bit less of those fire particles. Yeah, that's pretty good. All right, I'm liking it. Checking it in. Done for the day. So back to the fire boss. Undoing the changes I made. Oh, except for that. I want to just comment back in. Sequence shoot. This was timer shoot here. This is to that to 0.75 or so. Spides. Recompile. Take a look at the code. Cool. So I took out shot neutral so he can't be damaged by fire that spawned on a player. The shoot has a little bit less... random, and then the fireball spawns the fire explosion. But I think a fire trail does too. Hold on. Fire trail. Yeah, okay, let's convert all these to small explosion. Here comes a fire explosion. Explosion! Potion seller. I require your strongest potions. Alright, there. Now, when he does his fire trail attack, it should leave a fire explosion at the end, and his fire ball should do the explosion at the end. like seeing those with the end with the fiery little explosion. Good time watching, and I'll be back. I'm not sure exactly what day, maybe tomorrow. Same wizard time, same wizard place. I know, right? He's a little more awesome now. He got me. Oh well, it was a valiant effort. Oh, I see what's going on with these shaders and all that now. Alright, yeah, so have a good night, everybody. Enjoy. Yeah, sleep well, all y'all that are at 2 a.m. already. KO, no, totally, KO. I was knocked out. Alright, so yeah, have a great night. Thanks for watching. Appreciate you all. And catch you next time.